Welcome to another knee-trembling edition of the People's Republic of Brighton & Hove Take Over the Vote. We're going to get that on the T-shirt. It's going to be fantastic. Who have we got today, Debs?
Well, our second guest, Jason, is a filmmaker by the name of Judith Ricketts.
Ooh.
But first, would you like to bring on our first guest?
Oh, Jason? Let's bring on Katie Glover from coastal West Sussex. Mind. Hi, Katie. Welcome
to the
Republic.
Hi there. Really nice to be here. Thanks for inviting me today.
No problem.
So, Katie, you're from the coastal West Sussex branch of Mind.
Yeah.
So what we'd really like to hear about during this interview is what services your service offers.
Okay, yeah.
Opportunity to have volunteers and any other information that you think our viewers might find useful.
Okay.
We'll just have to sit down.
Okay. Yeah. No, I mean, I think one of the first things that might be useful for your viewers to understand is the difference between National Mind and Local Mind.
Right, yes.
So we're a local mental health charity in West Sussex and we're affiliated to, but we're actually independent from National Mind, which makes it slightly different. Mm-hmm. So we're just operating in West Sussex. Mm-hmm. We've got two main things we're trying to do. One of those is to change attitudes and behaviour about mental health and raise awareness. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is trying to make sure that people who need help can get help. So one of our mission is that we believe no one should have to face a mental health problem on their own.
Right. Yeah.
So one of the key things for us is that we're really happy for anybody to ring us at any time and to ask for advice and information, and we will try and, you know, we will try and help.
It's a 24-hour service.
It's not a 24-hour service, no. So we're not a crisis service.
Right.
We're kind of a Monday to Friday, 9-to-5 service.
Okay.
But we are there for anyone to give us a ring and have a conversation with us.
Okay.
In terms of support... Yeah. We have got our main way that we deliver that is through our support hubs, and we've got one in Worthing and one in Littlehampton, and a kind of little baby support hub in Midhurst as well. The first thing, if someone gets in contact with us, we just have a conversation with them.
Yes.
We find out what's going on for them and what they think they will need, and that's really, really important for us because we're not like kind of health services, and we're all about starting with the person.
Yeah.
Finding out what's going on for them and what they want. And sometimes what they need is not what we can offer.
Mm-hmm.
So we will give them advice and tell them what the places that they can go to
get.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. But also, we do have services we can offer.
Mm-hmm.
We have social activities because quite a lot of people who have mental health problems are very isolated. We do learning and personal development around helping people to manage their own mental health problems themselves. And the other thing that we do, and this links to volunteering, is we have peer mentors. So those are people who've got mental health problems themselves, but perhaps are managing better, who actually we train them, and they can then offer help to other people with mental health problems as well.
The person receiving that mentoring would feel a lot more comfortable and relaxed around somebody who kind of knows what they've been going through or has been through a similar experience.
Exactly. It's really positive. It's also, we talk about something called hope.
Yeah.
So if you meet someone who's actually in a better place when you're not in a good place, that's really good for you. So we have, that's our main services, but we've also, we've got a young people's mental health service as well for 16 to 25 year olds. And we've also got a really good service called Families in Mind, which we run with family centres, and that service is there for parents with young children where they're struggling with their mental health. And the other thing is that we've also got some services for older people as well in Chichester and Arran district. So quite a lot of services.
Is it a charity?
Yes, so we're an independent charity, and as I said, we're affiliated to National Mind, independent.
So they're affiliated all over the country, I believe.
Yeah, so lots of local minds. So some of your viewers might know of Mind in Brighton and Hove.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So they're another independent one affiliated.
How independent then? Is it just easier to run that
It's
way?
It's just the model. I mean, the way that I often explain it to people, to be honest, it's a bit like a franchise.
Yeah.
I can say franchise, but it sounded a bit
I think that's often the easiest way to explain it, actually, to people.
So you have a set of
of ways of doing
it. So we're all trying to achieve the same thing, and we work within the same values and policies, but in terms of our funding, and that's really important, we have to find our own money. So we don't actually get money from National Mind. We have to make our own.
I just think because you're independent of the other ones, you can actually adjust yourself to that situation better,
that
rather
area,
than having a strict set of rules.
Exactly. And actually, so West Sussex is really different from Brighton and Hove, because we've got a lot of people living in rural communities.
So
West Sussex is a massive area.
It's massive,
And you've only got three.
So we have our support services in the coastal and Downs area. We from sort of Midhurst through Chichester, Bognor, and across to Worthing. But we also, the work that we do to change attitudes and behaviour, and we do a lot of training, and we've got an anti-stigma project as well. We do that across West Sussex.
Do you think, because what I can gather, stigma is a big reason why people don't ask for help when it comes to having a mental health issue.
Yeah.
Do you feel that there's been a shift in that in recent times, or is there still quite a long way to go in order to cure that, as it were?
There's definitely been a shift in it. We're working with the national campaign Time to Change, and we've had some funding to launch Time to Change West Sussex. Got my badge on today, my Time to Change West Sussex badge. And Time to Change has been going for 10 years, and they monitor it. They've got all sorts of social research going on, and they monitor the change in public attitudes, and it has changed a lot. But it's still not totally there, and there's still quite a long way to go.
I know since when, like, Corbyn became the leader of the Labour Party, he really concentrated on mental illness, mental health and stuff like that. Has that helped to bring it to the fore, do you think?
Definitely. I mean, we were absolutely amazed. I think it was 4 years ago when mental health was a kind of election campaigning issue. We've never, ever seen that before in the mental health field. Yeah. And now, increasingly, we're seeing politicians taking mental health much more seriously, because I think, you know, if one in four of the population have a mental health problem, in terms of them needing to feel that they're actually reaching out to the public and the community around mental health, I think they agree it's very important.
Mental health is feeling safe as well. Being safe to say, I've got this problem.
Yeah.
And working with professionals or volunteers or mentors who you can actually trust.
Yeah.
Because I think trust must be such a big issue if you're going to actually disclose and have treatment for a mental health condition. You want to be with people, as you said, that you feel safe with.
Yeah.
So I think that's really positive that you see that you're managing that for people and making that happen.
Yeah.
In terms of fundraising, so where does your funding come from?
Okay, so about 60% of the money that we get comes from health and local government grants, but we do have to also raise money. So we're really lucky to have people from the community, also people who use our services, who really want to help us and to raise money for us.
So you get grants from the government, but you also got to match that in charitable donations?
For some services, we have to match it. So for example, our youth service, we get about 30% of that from grant, and the rest that we're funding for charitable funding. But some of our other services, we get 100% of the funding. So it's different for different services.
So if there are any West Sussex based or otherwise fundraisers, they can contact you if they want to do some fundraising for you?
Definitely. Okay. And, you know, it is really important to get that fundraised money in, because the more money we can raise, the more we can do. Yeah. So an example at the moment is we've got a lot of rural areas where there's no mental health support at all, and so that's something we really want to try and do more on. So places like Stenning and Storrington, which are kind of just in the Downs, don't really have any services.
And I think those areas do kind of get left behind a bit, definitely. So it's really good to hear that you are reaching out to people who probably are that bit more isolated through living in those areas.
Yeah.
I mean, one thing I will say is, if you ever do have any events or anything like that that you want to plug any fundraising, do come back and tell us, because we're all about the kind of fundraising.
Yeah. And we've got a Facebook page, we'll put details
yeah,
up
absolutely.
On the screen.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's really good to know. Definitely, we will, yes. Absolutely.
Even though you're worthy, you're not Brian Hope, you know, we reach out.
We do.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because it's important, because I do think one thing that I've noticed about charitable organisations is they don't always have a voice, they don't always have the opportunity to talk about what they do. And with something that's as important as mental health, you know, we really want to kind of share what you're doing. Yeah. So that's brilliant. So we'll be getting some details up on screen, up on the Facebook page.
Yeah, sure, that'd be fine. Yeah,
yeah, that's great.
Definitely. Well, I think we're coming to the end of this section.
Yes,
I want to say a big
thank you.
I'd like to also mention you were saying you did a 10-mile run yesterday.
Oh, that's true. Person. Yeah, yeah. Well, actually, no, I did. Because, I mean, one thing, just to say, linking to mental health, I'm really passionate about the benefits of physical exercise on mental health. So, like, for me, kind of trying to do the running, it's a really important way to stay mentally healthy.
I'm surprised you're standing up after 10 miles.
Yeah, just standing up.
I think we would be.
We would be much help.
But,
that's brilliant. Thanks, Katie. So, that's really
thank
good.
Thank you very much.
Really nice to come here. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks. And we'll see you after some adverts.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Welcome back!
Welcome back. That's brilliant. I was going to say exactly the same thing.
Debs, you've changed.
I know. Do you think I look better?
Yeah,
I look
actually,
taller and I sport the numbers so much. Hey, listen, actually, whilst we're here, let me connect up with the brilliant interview that you and Debs did. And just say, if you're a member of Brighton & Hove Republic, and you're looking for some mental health support, try the My Life Directory, which has a list of all the support organisations in our area, and I promise you we'll get a link for that up onto our Facebook page.
Who's next, Andy?
Well, before next, we've got to recognise the fact we've come home.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's very nice radio.
Yes, I mean, yeah. It's like, we're the radio's back. We're back on radio.
We've got a face for radio, but
yes,
unfortunately, we're on television.
Oh, sorry. Who's our next guest?
It's Judith Ricketts.
Oh, wow. Let's bring Judith on. Judith, come on.
It's People's Republic.
What? Hello, Judith.
Where? Good afternoon. Yeah.
Welcome to the radio studio.
Fantastic.
It's lovely, isn't it?
It's very large. Very nice.
I am so resisting making jokes about whether you want to play with any of the knobs. See, I didn't make that joke.
He resisted it.
We don't do that.
He resisted it.
Especially when we think about why you're here.
Yes, very serious matter.
Let's start with that.
What?
Judith,
yes,
why
hello.
Are you here?
I'm here because I want to talk about my practice. I'm a filmmaker and photographer.
Excellent, yes.
And I'm making films about Brighton & Hove, the history of Brighton & Hove. Partly because I am from this country. I live in Brighton. But I don't see in the environment any way of finding out what the history of other people are in this city. So the inspiration for that, I suppose, if you like, is that, you know, I stood on the beach looking out to the horizon one day and I thought, well, I don't see myself reflected in this landscape. I don't see myself reflected in terms of my contribution, my history, any narrative. And, you know, I know that it's a Regency town. That's when that's its heyday, really. And aside from the Prince Regent, George IV, there's really no history. It seems to be a historyless place. So one of the things I thought, well, okay, we know that I kind of discovered that the slave trade ended at the end or the beginning of the Regency period. So therefore, there must be some sort of connection. You know, there are other cities who are overtly aware of their connection to the slave trade. And so I went off to find some information and some data.
Wow.
So you're basically making a film about black slavery in the Brighton area? So
yes. So right. I've made three. And the first was called Of the Sea. And it's some data I found which directly relates, if you like, Brighton with Jamaica. Because my heritage, my parents are from Jamaica. I wanted to see if there was any connection initially. I found that there were seven slave owners who lived in the city who owned just under 2,500 people in Jamaica.
Wow.
It's a lot of people.
Yes.
And at the time I was doing a BA in photography and then switched whilst on the photography course to make films. So I made a short film about it. And the idea was that you start to connect people and places. And then you can start to build a different kind, different series of stories. Mm. It's not that we are rejecting the stories that are already here. We, you know, we love our Prince Regent and, etc. But we also want to know about other narratives that make the city.
Were there any really big surprises in your research? Did you?
Yes, I suppose one of the things I hadn't realised is that, you know, people would own one or two people, and almost 50% of the people who owned people were women. I initially thought it would be mostly men, etc., etc. The data has developed since then, and I've widened the search from Jamaica to the Caribbean. And what I'm looking at are 30 people of Brighton who owned just under 9,000 people in the Caribbean, 11 countries in the Caribbean. And so that film has become a 10-minute film. And so that's, if you like, the next chapter. That's in post-production at the moment. If you like, it has become a series of chapters. So the first chapter was about Jamaica. The second chapter was about the Caribbean as a whole. And the third chapter is much more about an interactive piece of work, which gives voice to the people and numbers that we have found. So far it's about Brighton and the buildings, and now we're going to be concentrating on people.
So I have two questions after that, if I may.
Yeah, sure.
One is, now that you're going around Brighton and Hove yourself, are you looking at it differently? Are you finding yourself seeing it differently? And the other is there a large population of former slaves here?
Well, there would have been at the end of the slave trade, because a lot of these former slave owners who potentially overseas would have brought staff from London and to Brighton for the Brighton season, backwards and forwards with the Prince Regent. There are very few records of those individuals that I have found just at the moment. And also, in order to document people, their categorisations were different. I mean, you could be effectively white and from the Caribbean, but described as a West Indian in those days. So you have to unpick that information as well. Nice. And do I see the city differently? Yeah. Yes, I love the city. I love Regency architecture. I love what it represents. I also know that there is another side to that. And that side to that plugs into a timeline of history that, may or may not be relevant. But what it then starts to do is other stories come forward. Mm. You know, I talked to a friend who came to see my work, and she talked about her history being of Roma and European Roma, but ending up in Brighton very early on. So her grandfather was here, and he was a photographer, and his work exists in the keep. And it starts to people start to talk to you about other histories, and I think it gives it a richer context. I feel more at home here. I've always felt at home here, but even more so.
Yes. What I'm curious about is, because you're talking about talking with more people, and I know when we spoke before coming on air, you're looking to open up those more contacts. Can you tell us something about that? Yes. How can the members of our wonderful, the citizens of our wonderful republic, get involved? Do you want them involved?
I'd love people involved. It always makes life easier, doesn't it? Well, I may or may not regret that. We'll see. I am looking for anyone who wants to work collaboratively with different alternative narratives.
Yes.
Specifically in terms of my interactive project, I'm looking for the wider community, people who are of West African extraction, who can add voices to my interactive work. So we're hoping that, you know, at some point there will be not only a film, but an environment which starts to bring that history to life, starts to tell you about which people lived where and how many people they owned effectively and where those people potentially came from. So you start, and potentially, if the research goes well, or it may not, because the records are so disjointed, potentially it would be great to know what language they spoke.
Is there a lot of black history on record? Did they keep lots of records?
Yes. I mean, the history, or the documents that I'm referring to, is a project that is a research project in London.
Right.
There isn't a lot of black history per se in Brighton, but there is some beings starting to be put together. But Williams and the Black History Group are doing a lot of work on that. They are also working on the Thomas Highflyer project, which is the story of a slave who's buried in Sussex. But it's essentially quite fragmented. Sure. And that will be one of the other stages, which is to have a suppository, sorry, an opportunity to put this in one sort of online resource. Sure. So that, you know, I'm thinking of doing some research and I've already got 7 or 8 archives, big archives that I'm looking at. And there's no single place to find it.
What a lovely idea.
It's going to be a challenge.
a lot of the history would be word of mouth, I guess, passed down from family.
Yes. I mean, that the oral history is quite important, but the difficulty is that, for example, someone like me, I didn't know my grandfather. Mm. I knew my grandmother for a period of time. And then I was. She went to the States. So there is an awful lot of fragmentation in that kind of history. And so, in order to reconnect the dots, we are having to look at, you know, the archival records that were of the plantations which were surveyed.
Right. Okay. I'm really sorry to have to interrupt because we're going to have to bring this whole section to an end. What we'll do is we'll get your contact details up so they can contact you. There's so many more questions we'd like to ask. There really are. I'm sorry about bringing it to an abrupt end. But, you see, that's all we have time on
the
show,
really. Thank you for having me.
Let's see. We need to tell people about what's coming up on the next show.
We do.
Yeah. Which, just to tease, we've got the Madeira Terrace raffle and auction coming on.
Wonderful.
And wouldn't it be nice to link up with them? And also, we've got a group coming in talking about a food journey.
Ooh, can I interview them?
Well, I'm sure, which I believe involves a little bit of kinky kind of blindfolding.
Yeah, definitely me.
Okay. Anyway, thank you everybody very much.